It earned its reputation in virtually every theater of the Second World War. And yet, the model is practically outdated when the war begins. As large and ungainly as an albatross, this flying boat still holds lasting appeal. It isn't the largest or the fastest, but more than any other plane in its class, it gets the job done over and over again. I'm Paul Max Moga, and I've flown some of the most sophisticated planes ever built. This is the Military Aviation Museum in Virginia Beach, Virginia, home to one of the largest collections of restored warbirds in the world. Of all the flying boats ever built, the consolidated PBY, the Catalina, is the hands-down favorite. Prior to World War II, before paved runways were common, flying boats solved the difficult problem of where to land a large aircraft. Its large, high-mounted wings supported by stays reveal its not-so-distant biplane ancestry.
My name's Don Anklin. I work for the Military Aviation Museum here in Virginia Beach as the Director of Restoration, and I'm also Chief Pilot and a PBY pilot.
All right, Don, so here we are at the PBY. I mean, she's a little bit of a flying monstrosity, but Tell me what you know about why the plane was developed. What need was it filling?
The Navy wanted something that could go long distance for search and rescue. You know, boats that needed help in the ocean. Yeah. Big, you know, open water type of search and rescue.
So a SAR platform.
Yeah, basically, yeah.
And I guess the first thing that I realize when I look at this is that it doesn't have to land on our runway. I mean, it's a boat.
Yeah, the original intent of this airplane and the original design was no wheels.
None.
They
had always just, off,
flying
off the
water. Boat. It was a flying boat, yeah. So in this version of the airplane, they had two different versions. They had one was the total flying boat, and then they had the 5A, which meant it had landing gear on it.
Even this government film of the period, titled Black Cat, suggests that the PBY's success comes in an unlikely package.
Anything familiar? That torso with a middle-aged sag? Her speed less than some cars can do. Maneuverable? Some days all right, on others she brings around like a 10-ton truck. She dives under protest. Wings can't handle half the pressure dive bombers take. Got her? Right. The old cat. Navy Catalina patrol boat, PBY in a black nightgown for night camouflage. A black cat.
In a war that spawns the jet airplane, the ballistic missile, and the atomic bomb, this sturdy flying boat offers reliability, range, lifting power, and above all, endurance. It can fly all day nonstop missions, take heavy punishment, and still bring crew and passengers home. Again and again, the Catalina proves worthy of its legend. Twenty years before the Catalina, designers tinkered with plans for flying boats. World War I, the first conflict to fully exploit military aviation, sees an immediate need. The prime target, the submarine. Silent and extremely effective, German U-boats become a highly economical weapon of war. The Allies quickly realized that a flying boat with sufficient range and lifting power could become an effective anti-U-boat bombing platform. Even when used for reconnaissance, aircraft pose a serious threat to submarines. toward the end of the war, when Allied flying boats score direct hits on Axis submarines, the threat increases and a trend is set. By the late 20s and early 30s, the biplane flying boat becomes a very practical prototype for large airplanes. Unlike most other military planes hangared until call to war, many Coast Guard flying boats see regular service, not only for weather observation, but often to rescue sick or injured seamen. In the 30s, these peacetime mercy missions proved the unique value of flying boats. And that value only increases in the war-torn years to come. Coast Guard flying boats stationed in San Diego see many mercy dashes between the wars. This area of Southwest California, with its warm, stable air and nearby flat desert, also attracts early flying pioneers eager to develop their technology. In 1935, aviation pioneer Reuben Fleet, who controls Consolidated Aircraft, moves the company's factory from the cold of Buffalo, New York, to the warmth of San Diego. One of the factory's early commissions comes from the Navy to prepare plans for a new flying boat. Unlike previous flying boats, this one will be a monoplane, designated PB for patrol boat and Y to denote the manufacturer. With this big commission comes big risk. The Depression has made contracts scarce and competition fierce. And plane making is still the domain of skilled craftsmen, not huge factories. Not until this one. The PBY Catalina is known by many nicknames, including Black Cat, Pig Boat, Mad Cat, Nomad, P-Boat, Mop, and Dumbo. In 1936, in the midst of the Great Depression, the aviation company Consolidated Aircraft takes a risk by accepting a large commission from the U.S. Navy for 60 deliveries of its PBY-1. However, their large factory is about to change the game in the aircraft production industry. The PBY-1 is about to become the first production version of the Consolidated Catalina. In the main wing assembly area, the sophisticated steel fabrication and old world hand stitching join forces to create the massive PBY wing. This wing is the key to the PBY design. It not only provides great lift, but also carries the entire fuel load, giving the PBY its legendary range. Two portholes in the center of the wing provide access to the main fuel tanks.
How about like fuel capacity? I would assume that these things could fly forever. Just basic reconnaissance tactics.
Absolutely. This airplane can hold 1,750 gallons of fuel. At a standard normal cruise, she'll burn 100 gallons an hour. You can bring it back to economy cruise. That's 17 and a half hours in the air with no reserve.
That's a long time.
Next, the rugged main spar heads to the fabric department, where durable, unbleached cotton is tied to the wing with knotted stitches that can't come undone. The combination of fabric and metal provides lightness and strength. Putting them together takes hundreds of hours of exacting craftsmanship. In its final step, the wing gets coated with a resilient lacquer that pulls the canvas taut and bonds the components together. Each rib gets extra reinforcement. The PBY's all-metal hull needs tens of thousands of rivets. Punched out of steel, Consolidated's rivet machine produces over a million rivets each week. Given the extra stresses the hulls of flying boats endure with every landing, joints have to be especially rugged. To keep the rivet steel at its most workable and to provide the tightest fit, each batch is frozen until ready for use. Metal ribs and stringers form the hull's skeleton. The hull bears the brunt of the landing impact, enduring the weight of the plane and the buffeting of the seas while keeping water tight. Wooden wedges ensure the closest fit between framework and skin, and only when the seal is perfect is the entire hull rotated to its upright position and moved on to the next process. The fuselage takes form as thousands of components get fitted to the tightest tolerances. The center spar that supports the wing also houses the flight engineer. He sits perched above the two pilots, close to the two engines he constantly monitors. At this stage, the shark-like profile of the hull is almost complete. To make sure it's seaworthy, it's filled with water and checked for leaks. Then it goes to the paint shop where it's scraped and painted. In the paint room, large fans produce positive air pressure, keeping dust and contaminants out. The completed fuselages stand ready for their main wing spars. These early model PBY-3s, with their distinctive flat-side canopies, are part of a pre-war order of 65 aircraft placed by the United States Navy. Next, the main wing spar gets fitted to the center column. The wings are thick. The center section is almost completely occupied by fuel tanks, holding 1,750 gallons. The fuel feeds two 1,200 horsepower Pratt & Whitney twin Wasp engines. They're secure to the wing with just 4 bolts each. The dry California climate eliminates the need for a massive hangar. Finally, the plane is assembled outside. The PBY's retractable wingtip floats can be raised in flight to extend the wing and improve handling. Then they lower for landing. During original manufacturing, each plane must pass a thorough inspection before it's handed over to the Navy. From 1936 to 1945, with just 9 short years of production, a total of 3,290 PBY Catalinas were made. After years of perfecting early models of the PBY, Consolidated Aircraft creates what will be the first version of the Catalina to be produced in large numbers, the PBY-5. With the props just feet behind the pilot's head and the engineer and pilot sitting apart, communication is through headsets. Understanding crew members is essential for a successful mission and a safe return home. On March 28, 1938, the new PBY-5 makes its maiden flight, powerful and rugged. To conserve fuel and increase range, the craft can fly on a single engine. Like most successful aircraft, the PBY evolves to fit changing needs. In December 1939, the U.S. Navy commissions about 200 PBY-5s as boat bombers, but that is just the beginning. In 1940, the delivery of the first Royal Air Force PBY signals the start of a long relationship. The RAF even gives the PBY its popular name, the Catalina. Besides the PBY, the British also order an amphibious aircraft, the PBY-5A. Though heavier, slower, and with less range than the Catalina, the PBY-5A can operate on sea and land, making it more versatile. Nearly half of the aircraft delivered to the RAF are amphibious. The Catalina's 4,000-mile range proves indispensable to maintaining the supply lines between North America and Britain. Operating from bases in the North Atlantic, PBYs escort the vulnerable supply convoys, which would otherwise be sitting ducks for the predatory German U-boats. RAF Catalinas carry the British-designed ASV, Aircraft-to-Surface Vessel Anti-Submarine Radar, to supplement visual observation. Once a U-boat is spotted, the PBYs launch an attack with bombs and depth charges.
How about so it could take out targets with bombs? Did it have anything else? Did it have guns on it? Did it have torpedoes? I think I remember hearing that.
Yeah, they dropped torpedoes. They had rockets on them, believe it or not. And they had torpedoes. They had all kinds of stuff on these things. They had depth chargers they would drop in the water. Guns, yeah, it had guns, but it was mostly for offense. They had 250 caliber waist guns, and then they had, depends on what version, they had a 50 caliber nose gun or 230s.
Yeah.
And then they had what, a little stinger gun, which they could pull a door open in the back and stick another 30 out of it.
And all those defensive, obviously.
Just defensive. They couldn't do anything else with it.
I can't fathom trying to strafe something.
Well, this is a sitting.
This
was a sitting duck, this airplane here. I mean, it you know, 105 knots. That's it.
Ooh,
I mean, that's
boy,
where she
smoking.
Goes.
On December 7th, 1941, the Japanese conclude the conflict with a cruel blow to the U.S. 7th Fleet. At Pearl Harbor, PBYs take their share of the battering. The PBY first proves its legend during the Battle of Midway. The stage for this infamous battle is set in the cold of the Aleutian Islands. The four groups of islands form part of Alaska.
In the early days of June 1942, the Japanese used the weather to try and push American forces out of the Pacific. From behind a bank of storms, they dispatched two invasion forces with two widely separate objectives, Midway Island and Dutch Harbor. The operation is designed to shatter the American line of sea defenses along the Pacific coast. The unit cost of a single PBY Catalina in 1935 was $90,000. In June of 1942, the Japanese make a bold move to secure absolute domination of the Pacific Ocean. Using a moving bank of storms, they dispatch two invasion forces with two widely separate objectives, Midway Island and Dutch Harbor. The Japanese lose the element of surprise and the battle. The decisive United States victory over the Japanese carrier force at Midway breaks the back of Japanese naval air power. On the northern front at Dutch Harbor in the Aleutians, the American forces also prepare an effective counterattack. Facing unbearable weather, PBY patrols persevere in their search for Japanese U-boats. Thanks to the PBYs, Japanese U-boats in the Pacific enjoy none of the early success of the German U-boats in the Atlantic. And American subs fare well in the Pacific because the Japanese have nothing like the PBYs to flush them out.
the Americans hold the line. Dutch Harbor is as close as the Japanese ever come to mainland America. Again, the Catalina plays its part. But the PBY has rivals of its own on the home front, like the more advanced Martin Mariner twin-engine long-range reconnaissance bomber. Several models of this flying boat are produced long after the war. This particular one replaced many of the older Catalina squadrons as the famous consolidated flying boat started to age. Back at Consolidated San Diego plant, PBY construction forges ahead, almost throughout the war. Even with the later models available, the original 1933 model is the one to beat. By now, manufacturers besides Consolidated build the Catalina. Boeing, Vickers, and the Naval Air Factory tool up to meet the demand. The U.S. Navy alone wants 3,000, and big orders come in from the British, other Commonwealth nations, and the Dutch. The PBY-5A dominates the production lines, both in its flying boat form and the more versatile amphibious model. The 5A and later versions feature large blister canopies on each side of the rear fuselage. The canopies provide excellent visibility for the gunner positioned inside. Although the Catalina leads Consolidated's war effort, it isn't the only flying boat they have in production. In 1936, the company makes ready for the much larger four-engine heavy patrol bomber, the PB-2Y, the Consolidated Coronado. The PBY had set new standards in its day, but now thoughts turn to larger four-engine flying boats. The British start the trend and successfully develop the four-engine Sunderland. This Coronado flying boat is San Diego's answer. The gigantic Consolidated PB-2Y Coronado boasts four large engines and a double-decker fuselage, but it still uses retractable floats. Consolidated produces this model, number 29, only as a flying boat. The Coronado ends service in 1945, with only a few produced. Many of the patrol bomber versions will become naval ambulances, with accommodation for up to 25 stretchers. What had once made flying boats like the Coronado unique and popular will soon contribute to its slow decommission from military service. With the war comes thousands of new airstrips around the world, so water landings and takeoffs become unnecessary. The era of large flying boats draws to a close. Consolidated finds new success in its four-engine bomber, B-24 Liberator. Though designed for ground landings, it bears a striking resemblance to its flying boat predecessor. The factory turns out more than 12,000. Meanwhile, on remote Pacific islands, the basic Catalina PBY gets on with the business of war, laden with bombs, depth charges, torpedoes, and 50 caliber machine guns. Despite its impressive payload, aside from machine guns, the PBY has few weapons to defend itself with. But the flat black finish that helps it disappear into the night sky has transformed the PBY into the legendary Black Cat. Throughout the Second World War, the U.S. Navy operates from secret bases scattered across the Pacific. PBYs work alone, performing aerial reconnaissance, mine laying, air-sea rescue, dive bombing, and torpedo attack missions. Success hinges on the skilled men who fly and maintain the PBYs under less than ideal circumstances. On a remote island, experience and improvisation are the best and only teachers. The Catalina's high, closely mounted engines make steering difficult when taxiing. Throttles must be opened gradually on takeoff to minimize the blinding spray that can damage the propellers. Under heavy weights and other conditions, the PBY might need 3 miles of run-up before the Cat finally takes to the air to prowl the sky.
And this airplane, another neat thing about this airplane is it doesn't have flaps. There's no flaps. It does not have flaps. So the airplane is an airplane that you gotta, it'll come out of the water relatively, you know, decent with a standard load, but they've been known to go 3.5 miles down the river before they get them off the ground with a full load.
Usually flying into dusk and frequently into turbulent tropical weather, the crews accept a rough ride as a normal operating condition. Without the usual electronic navigation aids, plotting the PBY's course is more art than science. And while a starless night provides some safety from Japanese night fighters, it also eliminates the crew's only navigational resource. A small break in the clouds allows a quick star sighting from the exposed nose turret, confirming the PBY's course. On this night, Black Cat crew search for a Japanese convoy, thought to be at anchor in an enemy harbor. As the PBY carefully reduces altitude, the crew strains to find their target. Right now, stealth is their only weapon. If the Black Cat gets too close, the sound of the engines will draw fire from the Japanese anti-aircraft guns. Jacques Cousteau used an amphibious PBY-6A as part of his diving expeditions. On June 28, 1979, his second son, Philippe, was killed while attempting to land a PBY in the Tagus River near Lisbon, Portugal. While the PBY is notorious for its slow speed, topping out around 200 miles per hour, the Black Cats have a primitive but effective strategy against the Japanese ships below. By painting the plane solid black, the Black Cats have the advantage of stealth. Because many Japanese ships lack radar, they can close in on them undetected and inflict heavy damage. Despite the intense Japanese fire, the Cat sees no sign of the convoy. The search continues out at sea, under the threat of the Japanese night fighters, now alerted to the PBY's presence. Most Black Cats have replaced their bomb sights with radar altimeters to enable low-altitude flight in the dark and accurate low-level bombing. Skimming just above the water, the Black Cats are practically invisible to Japanese night fighters. Over the dark sea, even a large convoy can be elusive. On moonlit nights, the trick is to get the enemy between the cat and the moon. When the crew spots their target, in this case a convoy of ammunition freighters, they signal other cats in the area. The cats load up for their meeting with the convoy. For a mission like this, a cat will typically carry two 500 and 2,000 pound bombs, or two 500 pound bombs and a torpedo. Still, against a convoy, it's David versus Goliath. They can manage steep dives, though the enormous high mountain wings shudder with the strain. In a dive from 3,000 feet down to masthead level, pilots report that the wings really flap. Besides their bombs, cats can use their machine guns to retaliate against anti-aircraft fire from the ships. Even in this lopsided battle, the cats scored extraordinary success. Between November 1943 and June 1944, U.S. Navy PBY Squadron BP-52 destroys or damages 16 enemy ships, including submarines, tankers, cruisers, and destroyers. Many other PBY squadrons throughout the Pacific had comparable records, and more often than not, after prowling around in the night and taking an impossible amount of punishment, these cats come back. But the glory doesn't belong to the air crew alone. Ground engineers have the crucial and daunting task of repairing the damage sustained in the night missions. Maintaining the Pratt & Whitney double wasps on a remote island in the Pacific demands ingenuity, recycling old parts or cobbling together replacements. Fortunately, the PBY is a plane that demands little and forgives much. Often, they require little more than a pair of tin snips to patch bullet holes, a not so subtle reminder of just how precarious these night missions can be. PBYs aren't only instruments of aggression. Throughout the war, they troll the oceans for survivors of air battles in theaters across the globe. These so-called Dumbo missions save the lives of hundreds of airmen and sailors.
So when this thing went out on search and rescue missions, obviously it's over the ocean and there's probably not any ships around because they're sending this in. So talk to me how they would do that. They would land this thing
in the ocean. Yeah, they'd land it in the open water. And if the swells were real big, they'd do what they call a full stall landing, where they get the thing just right at the point of a stall and hopefully they'd hit the top of a wave and then ride the wave down.
And just plop it in?
And plop it in, full stall. And I've seen pictures in the books where they'd have the tail just right in the water and just plopping it right into
that's
full stall.
That's old school flying. Yeah,
and believe me, I've done some stall landings on this airplane on wheels, and it takes a lot of muscle.
Yeah.
To make a rescue, the pilot often has to execute full stall landings on swells of 8 feet or more. Sometimes the rescue crew finds itself in the water, waiting for the comforting drone of the next cat to come along. Laden with survivors and crew, the overburdened cat might be too heavy to take off. The pilot would have to drain fuel and jettison cargo. With over 20 people on a large, angry sea, the pilot needs good luck and better timing. If on takeoff a large swell throws the cat in the air, so much the better. A skilled pilot will seize the moment, grab the throttle, and hope for the best. Few planes other than the PBY can handle this kind of maneuver. Not all Catalinas serve in the military. As the war in the Pacific wears on, the Australian airline Qantas flies 5 Catalinas in continuous service from Perth to Colombo, modern-day Sri Lanka. Each plane holds a maximum of 3 passengers, and the flight takes 24 hours. The wear and tear on the engines and the passengers is phenomenal. To this day, these Qantas Indian Ocean flights remain the longest duration scheduled trips that any airline has ever offered.
The Catalina has a magnificent record, both in combat and civilian service. From the polar regions to the tropics, and in both hemispheres, it flies with a distinction achieved by few other planes. It isn't fast, it isn't agile. It just works. Because of their reliability, ease of service, and long range, civil airlines and small private operators after the war seek out the PBYs. Just how many veteran Catalinas flew over the land and sea for which they'd fought is hard to say. One thing is for certain, for a plane that was originally ordered in 1933, and considered by some to be obsolete by the war's end, the Catalina survived magnificently. And many, like this one, still fly today.